Good evening. I ask that you take your seats so we can begin the program this evening. Please also enjoy your salads while we're speaking to you here tonight. I know they'll be serving dinner in a little bit, but please go ahead and get started with your salads. I'm Karin Mallet, anchor and reporter for WFMZ-TV 69 News, and I'm so honored to be able to be here with you tonight for this sixth installment of Considerate Dinners. Tonight's is close to my heart. The conversation is to address not just one or two sides, but all sides of the media. And by media, it's a wide, diverse group. We are including not just traditional media, newspapers, radio, television, but all aspects of it. So we hope you will consider all that you hear tonight. Thank you to the Berks County Community Foundation for supporting the Considerate Initiative. State Senator Judy Schwenk and Berks County Commissioner's Chairman Christian Leinbacher, co-chairs of this nonpartisan group. Also committee members El-Sayed El-Marzouki, Bill Gage, Mary Cargbo, Joan London, Karen Miller, Art Grimm, Kevin Murphy, Michael Rivera, and Mary Lou Rodriguez-Bauer. We thank you for your continued dedication. Here's how it will work this evening. I will introduce each speaker, and he or she will present their thoughts. When the panelists are finished, we'll all have dinner together. So we'll be joining you down there. And the hope is that what you hear from the panelists will spur some interesting dinner conversation. At your tables, you will find some slips of paper. They look like this. And this is for you to write your questions on. So if your question is for a specific speaker, you can circle his or her picture and then write your question at the bottom. So if while a panelist is speaking, if you think of something that you would like to ask him or her, please jot it down. If while having dinner and you're discussing the topic at hand tonight, you think of something that you would like to have answered, please write it down on those sheets. I will be going around along with some other members of the Considerate Committee towards the end of the meal to collect those questions. The topic is media maze. Do you hear what I hear? And as I said, very close to my heart. I have been a television journalist now for 23 years. I graduated from New York University with a bachelor's in broadcast journalism and went to work as a news writer. I had a lot of titles, researcher, producer, guest booker for a nightly consumer news and investigative news magazine show on CNBC. We worked for days, for weeks, for months, even for years on just one particular story. We were never told no when we were asked for more time. You were granted really as much time as you needed. At the time, CNN, another 24-hour cable network news operation, was moving full speed ahead. CNN began as a broadcasting station back in 1980, but it really began to take off in the early 1990s. And in 1994, in the CNBC building, just a few floors down from our offices, we launched another 24-hour cable network called America's Talking. And then in another just two very short years, in 1996, our boss at CNBC, Roger Ailes, shut down America's Talking and used that space to create MSNBC. They were based in a warehouse just a few towns over from Fort Lee, New Jersey. It was the same year that another 24-hour cable news channel began, and that was Fox News. So I was right there sort of in the middle of it all and saw this switch to a 24-hour news cycle, which I felt at the time really went on to change the way that we were gathering and presenting the news. At the time, it wasn't enough anymore to just get information in a timely manner. In journalism, there has always been this tension of getting it first and getting it right. And since we're now filling 24 hours a day of programming, becoming first became a different kind of challenge. The content of news programming for us at CNBC really began to change. There were always op-ed and opinion pieces, but now we were delving into hours of analysis in real time, relaying the news in real time, and journalists made way for experts and analysts, all on TV and all accessible to the public. This idea of news had a new definition, and I think it became, again, a little more challenging for the public to discern if what they were hearing was fact or someone's opinion. a few years into my stint at CNBC, my show got canceled, which happens all the time in television, so I didn't really take that too much to heart. But I moved out of the 24-hour news cycle and became an anchor of Good Morning Carolinas in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, where I worked for an ABC affiliate. So it was my first local news station, and it was truly a local community news station. I felt lucky to work there. And living in the place where you work often makes you acutely aware of the impact that a half-hour broadcast has on the community, because it is your community, too. My managers there were quick to point out when we were not living up to that responsibility, and eventually made a quality of life decision and decided to stay in local news, but to be closer to home, and I found my way here to WFMZ-TV, where I've been now for almost 15 years. I wanted to share something with you that is posted on the wall of our break room. It is a mission statement, and it reads, "Our central purpose is to serve the public by providing information that helps viewers comprehend and navigate matters in their lives and the life of the community. What we stand for, fairness. We go out of our way to make sure competing ideas and the people who express them are represented with fairness, honesty, and nuance. Factuality. We provide a balanced factual context that empowers viewers to evaluate competing ideas. Proportion. We represent the significance of events without inflation. Responsibility. We are not arrogant or cavalier about the influence we wield or the impact we have upon the people in our stories. We recognize the media can be a Goliath, lumbering through people's reputations, livelihoods, dignity, and welfare. And accordingly, we are especially careful about each step we take. In our personal interactions, we treat people with civility and courtesy." It's posted on a lot of open spaces in our newsroom. It's in the restroom, so they have time to read it and sort of mull it over. But it really hits home for me, and I always take a minute to read it when I'm in the newsroom. So before this program tonight, I spoke with my news director. He mentioned there's a part of the mission statement that he always underscores, especially for new employees, and that's the part about accurately reflecting the nuances of people's positions and opinions. When you do a 20-minute interview with someone face-to-face and then only air a 15-second soundbite, it is very easy to lose the integrity of what they're saying. Our job is to make sure that that doesn't happen. In terms of what we cover, and I had a conversation with our Berks Edition executive producer about this, we're local first. So we cover breaking news as it happens. Stories come to us in a variety of ways. Viewer tips, scanner reports, press releases, social media posts, reporter-producer brainstorming, just by living and working in this community. In the newsroom, we're always looking for ways to expand and follow stories that are ongoing. There's a checklist that we follow, that we're supposed to be following at FMZ, and it's a series of questions that we should be asking ourselves while we're gathering the news. I have seen stories come back from the field and not make air because they just don't have enough components. They don't represent enough of the sides that make up the issue that we're covering. I became a journalist because I feel that everyone has a story, and I wanted to help people share those stories so that we get to know each other, our neighbors, strangers. We all live in this world together, and we have an impact on each other, and we should know what's happening around us, and we should know that there are areas that we can explore. Selfishly, I wanted a front row seat to all of that. I wanted to be part of that process, of the information process, and I wanted folks to get the information and then make their own decisions. And with that, I'm very excited to hear what everyone has to say tonight, so let's get started. We have five panelists from all walks of media, and we'll be going in alphabetical order. We begin with Derek Arnold. Derek is a communication instructor at Villanova University. He teaches about conspiracy theories and their connection with social media and news, the people who are most likely to believe in such theories, how the theories evolve, how they're covered by the media, and how to defend against them. He has been in education for 30 years and at Villanova for 14. He received his BA from LaSalle University and MA from Purdue. He's taught courses in political and business communication, persuasion, communication law, rhetoric, and crisis communication and scandal. Derek.
All right, thank you. A lot of people, great. I think in some ways this is actually perfect timing. In a couple of weeks you're going to be asked to vote in midterms. And one of the things I think that will be kind of important will be trying to figure out how do you get to the decisions you do? How do you wind up looking at the situation and making a well-informed or your best-informed decision on who to vote for? So to some extent, that's kind of what I try to do tonight. I'm trying to highlight things to pay attention to, things to look at. I'm not going to really be able to give you a whole lot in the way of answers, but hopefully give you some questions in a way. So some of the stuff I found out over the last couple of days before we got started, I was going first, and so that meant something, I guess. And as we said, we're doing a bathwater order, so there's no great key of the universe for me starting off here. But also a couple of other things. We were told that, unlike in previous sessions of Considerate, that we weren't going to be kind of, you know, hung up with fact-checking or the idea of the civility bell, which was something which is also in prior ones. So yes, we're vetted, and that's good. But then also I thought right away, well, what does that mean? I mean, what responsibilities do we have in order to try to talk to you about all these various areas here? And there's so much that kind of covers, you know, the things that we are bombarded with information-wise and the stuff that we typically have to think about on a daily basis. And so what I wanted to kind of do was, like I said, in some ways ask more questions than give you answers, but hopefully when we get toward the end in questions and answers section, maybe we can kind of come up with some ways of dealing with that. So with that in mind, there you go. Just a couple of quick questions to think about. You know, what are our values? Where do they come from? And the idea that you take years in many cases to develop those, what do we care about? Once we kind of have figured that out, we kind of then figure maybe we can find other folks that we tend to kind of, you know, are able to kind of coexist with in a way to talk about the things that we agree with, and that this is important because when it comes to particular issues that affect us and things that we care about, you know, which ones do we care about? And how do we go about trying to do something about that and the ways in which we kind of meet that? So to some extent, you know, again, how do we make our best or most informed decisions? It's going to be hard for you to see this, but this is something which is, it's from a person, I think, is it Valerie? Victoria Otero. She's a patent lawyer in Colorado, so it really has nothing to do with her background in a way. But what she started to do was to gather where she saw the different sources of information by the main channels and stuff. And this is actually the original one in 2016. She's updated it since then. But you can still get a couple of things here. And again, it's going to be a little bit hard to see. But one of the things is that the chart and the way she organizes it, kind of on the bottom, it goes from a liberal to a conservative kind of continuum. And then along the other axis, the up-down axis, it's looking at how developed the actual source is in the channel. Is it just something which is kind of like clickbait, as she kind of says? Or is it something which is more kind of thoughtful, or in some cases more intense as far as, you know, that kind of background? And the thing to maybe think about is that in many cases, this is hers. And one of the things when she put it out there and she tweeted it, that people looked at it and liked it, but then they started to have kind of particular kinds of setups with how is it that they're going to, you know, see where their particular source is at. And one of the things, you can look at it online, and one of the things I would probably, you know, say to you is that now that I've told you all that stuff, one of the first things you'll do is look and see where your sources are at, where they fit on here. And one of the things is that you may argue with things as far as, is it something that is more going to be, you know, left of center or right of center, but how developed it is as well. And one of the things that she said was right away, you should make your own. And that's kind of what I wanted to show you here. You can see these little balloons and kind of circles and shapes. And to some extent, please feel for encouraged to make your own. And one of the things that I wanted to kind of note is not that the sources you pick are going to fall in different categories, because they will, but note the particular kinds of shapes here. The ones kind of in the middle and higher are going to be a little bit more developed, and they're going to be a little bit more kind of moderate. And hopefully in a way by doing that, they're going to allow you to kind of get a balance of sorts. And that's kind of the key. But one of the things that happens is if you've got a particular kind of, especially if you go kind of to the sides or to the bottom, and that's where some of your sources are at, you have this possibility of what we call the echo chamber. And what happens is, you've probably heard the term, and it's just the idea that once you find an area, like we were saying, you have your values, you have the people you kind of typically talk to, you have the sources you typically go to, and the messages tend to be very comforting to you. You agree with them, you like them. They kind of reaffirm what your values are and kind of what it is you want to do with that. So with that's the case, you have a tendency to not want to leave those things. Plus, you have your lives, you know, on a daily basis. So when you check the news, it might only be 15 minutes in the beginning of the day. Might only be 10 minutes at the end of the night, kind of thing, before you go to bed. So you tend to go to those things, your touchstones, to kind of base, you know, your kind of values and opinions and what's kind of going on in the world around you. That's helpful, but what it also does is it's a little bit dangerous, because it keeps you in a particular area and you don't typically challenge yourself. You don't typically look at other sources. And I know it's hard. I try to do this constantly, and there are still times when I go, no, I just want to hear, I just want to see the stories that make me feel like, okay, what I'm thinking is actually an okay thing to think. So it's kind of important, I think, to note that the echo chamber is something that is very much a part of news. But really what I want to talk about for the basis of my time is that it's really not just the news per se, as we kind of mentioned. There's social media too. And social media also has this kind of idea of echo chambers also. When you look at these things, there's a lot of constraints upon us. One, we kind of think it's helpful because a lot of times you can read somebody's tweet. And then even though it's doubled to 280 characters, you know, when you count the spaces, the grammar, and the punctuation, you know, you're really only talking three or four sentences. And that doesn't really allow you a chance to be able to kind of get a good feel for a particular issue. And a lot of times, these are folks who, like Karin was saying, you know, there's a code of ethics, there's a training that goes with a journalist. These are folks who are not, in many cases. And so they might be well-intended, they might be thoughtful, but they may not be. They might all have an agenda. And when that's the case, it's up to you to try to be able to figure out how those things affect you. And that's hard sometimes to kind of do. When you look at things like Facebook and Instagram and Twitter, these are things that you kind of zip in and zip out. And they tend to really kind of, you know, be very limited in what they can offer you. If you're able to kind of look at that, that might be helpful and with that in mind. But sometimes what happens is when you look at those things and you typically follow people in places that are going to be helpful to you, you know, again, validifying your kind of ideas, that's going to be something that you like and you're going to stay with those. So what happens is social media also allows you to kind of get into that echo chamber to some extent. You kind of stay with what you like in some ways. And when you do that, you have a little bit more of a tendency, the more you read and the more you see, when you have particular kinds of people who are talking and saying things you like, you have a tendency to get a little bit more emotional. Things that you really kind of say, yes, this should be the case, or no, what is that person possibly thinking by, you know, having this kind of a comment or a thought about a particular issue. So you tend to kind of go toward those kind of edges, those fringe things. And like Karin said, one of the things I do, I teach a class in conspiracy theories. It's something that just started a few years ago. But it was something that I really enjoyed because it's something that the students, when they take it, they say, oh my gosh, I got all these questions and stuff. And then they're crushed because the first half of the course is just me talking about things like argumentation and checking sources and fact checking and stuff. And they go, but wait, who killed JFK? And what about Bigfoot or Loch Ness? Any of those kinds of things. And so what happens is when you look at this in the future of the course for them, and really for you guys, we all are pretty typically somebody who likes conspiracy theories. I mean, one of the things that studies kind of suggest is that with conspiracy theories, who believes in them? Really, we all kind of do. The farther away we think we are from power, per se, the more likely we're going to buy into at least one conspiracy theory. And typically, there are others that are pretty consistent or kind of have a connection. So we have a tendency to kind of fall on those things as well. The thing that makes it more alluring is, you know, when you think of a conspiracy theory, is it's an alternate explanation for something that is out there. So when you think about something like 9/11, or when you think about something along the lines of like somebody, you know, was involved with the assassination or something like that. This is something that typically means you have to have a story that goes with it. And stories are so important to our lives, but at the same time, they can also be a little bit dangerous as well. You know, you think of a story about what is happening behind the curtain that you don't know about, but people tell you is going on. So there are things with plots, characters, intrigue, you know, drama. And when you look at this, how easy is it to get sucked into that? I mean, one of the reasons I got into this was when he went back to, I think it was 2012, kind of that whole, the world's going to end kind of a thing, and how people wanted to look into that, the stories were just kind of amazing. And we were like, so, yes, the end of the world may come, but because it's on our watch, we're going to get front row seats of it, and that's going to be fun. And part of it is the stories and how they're kind of told. So that's certainly something, and some of the other folks here tonight are going to talk a little bit about like storytelling and some of the narratives that come out of that and how important they are to making points and issues. And that's part of where social media kind of hits as well. Finally with this, you know, again, if we want to be on the inside, we want to have kind of a glimpse of what power is going on, what else can we use here? Again, conspiracy theories is one thing, but another thing are memes. And, you know, the idea of a meme, and you can't really see as well in the back, but, you know, it's going to be my example in a second here. Memes are incredibly quick. You see a meme, within 5 seconds, you've acknowledged it, you've laughed, you looked at kind of what was going on, and you move on. But they're really kind of surprisingly complex. You know, they go back over 2,000 years. And so a meme is something which is just not since the internet. It's something which has been around forever. So with that in mind, know that memes typically have an argument to them. It's just like a typical major premise, minor premise, and a conclusion. The one example I want to show you is, you can't really tell, but this is the guy who was involved with the Dos Equis ads, the most interesting man in the world, and maybe you remember the guy. And his argument was typically, he would show him being incredibly interesting, and of course the net was set, and then he would say something like, you know, I don't normally drink beer, but when I do, I drink Dos Equis. And so there's kind of this form that they use in a bunch of ads afterwards, I don't normally, but when I do. And so this is something which kind of set up a kind of pattern, kind of a, it's a meme. And so what you can do is you can take that and you can start messing with it. And the thing is, if you understand the meme, if you understand the code and how to crack it, that really makes it interesting to how it is that you can then actually get a little sense of power, because you get the joke, you're on the inside of it. So like, for example, I took a meme generator of the guy in the picture, and I don't know if you can see that, but basically it says the same form. I don't normally remember all the scary ghost movies I've ever seen, but when I do, it's 3 a.m. And so when you look at it and it's something where you get it, again, for those that laugh, thank you, but for those who, you know, are getting it, it's a certain kind of power that goes with that. And the thing is, once you kind of get that, you can mess with a meme even more. Here's another one. All right, not the guy, but a Cookie Monster from Sesame Street wearing a kind of, you know, smoking jacket kind of thing, and he's basically saying, I don't always change my internet settings, but when I do, I enable cookies. Thank you. So when it happens and you get the joke, again, the fact that the form fits, you can make this work for you, and you actually get it, and you get the power in a way for understanding it in a way. So what does that mean as far as other kind of political memes? They're all around, they're very quick, and these are two that I hoped were generally kind of harmless, but show kind of a break in one side or the other here. Kind of an Obama, really almost more of a Biden and a Donald Trump one. If one of those appeals to you more than the other, it's an example, again, how memes can kind of serve as a kind of example of an echo chamber. And that's something that you want to try to make sure that you try to avoid in a way. Not at least be aware of, if that's the case. Enjoy them, have fun, that kind of stuff. But understand that the other side of the aisle, in a way, if somebody else is doing that, you also want to be careful as far as how do you think is that this is the only way that you kind of do that. And again, you can kind of fall into this echo chamber. So in the end, a couple of things just to wrap up with. Again, as far as questions go, think about where you place yourself as far as the particular groups that are out there, and maybe even more importantly, where have you been placed? Sometimes based on the media and based on other groups, you're kind of put into a particular category because of a couple things you think. Resist that. You are a walking contradiction. We all are. There are times you'll do something and afterwards you'll kind of go, why did I do that? And at the same time, you want to go, because I wanted to, because that's who I am. So remember that when you're going and looking at the things as far as values and issues and things that are important to you. And in the final, hopefully we'll be able to kind of talk about these kind of issues as well. But think about those things and question yourself as far as that goes. All right, I know Catherine is next, but thank you. And hopefully, again, we'll hopefully have some questions and stuff later on. Was it even close?
Yeah. Okay. And I have to apologize to the panelists. The timer isn't working, so I'll nudge you if you go a little over. So don't have to worry about looking at the timer. Our next speaker is Katherine Dunning Catanach. Katherine is an instructor of communication arts and sciences at Penn State Berks, where she teaches about fake news so that her students can determine whether they are digesting valuable and critical news, and so they can fact check and verify credible news sources. Before joining PSU Berks, she taught public speaking and public relations at Kutztown University and was an adjunct in the MBA program at Alvernia. She has more than 20 years of marketing and public relations experience in both for-profit and nonprofit organizations. She earned a bachelor's from Moravian College in advertising communications and a master's from Drexel in arts administration. She is an accredited member of the Public Relations Society of America. Katherine.
Good evening. Both of these work. That's awesome. I teach PR, I teach business communications, and I teach public speaking to mostly first-year students coming into college, which is a lot of fun. And so when we come up to this fake news concept, we at Penn State work very hard to make sure that our students are doing good critical analysis work in terms of their research and their scholarship. So a couple of things that I'm going to go over tonight is give you a little bit of a historical perspective, break down some fake news, and because I'm a professor, I have a quiz for you. We're going to talk a little bit about psychology, some fact-checking, and give the best practices for evaluating media. So in getting ready for tonight, I was thinking about what was the big first major disruptor that came on the scene for us as a society, as cultural people who consumed media. And really the big disruptor was Gutenberg and his press. I mean, that was sort of like, you know, back in the Middle Ages, that's the internet of the day. So, and there's lots of scholars out there that have done research on this and can talk about it, but I found this quote that I thought was really interesting from Ronaldo Rosaldio, who wrote an article called The Cultural Impact of the Printed Word. And what's so fascinating about this quote is that he talks about how out of the Renaissance and the Enlightenment, we got all of this enormous disruption, but we really got a cultural explosion, and that really set us up for some major changes. But take into consideration that while those folks at that time were in it, they didn't realize what was happening, and it took another 100 years on the other side of the Reformation and the Enlightenment to figure that out. So when you think about that from a historical perspective, about what those folks were going through to what goes on now in an internet minute, a hot internet minute, you think about how much information is now digested, redigested for you, and where you can spend your time in 60 seconds, it's pretty amazing. So the other thing that I want to talk about is, what is fake news? I think we want to break that down just a little bit. So we're looking at satire, parody, imposter sites, factual news sites, mixed fake real news, hyperpartisan, pseudoscience, clickbait, and some of those logos up there you might actually recognize. So get ready, here's your quiz. Here's a bunch of headlines. And I'm gonna ask you, which one of those do you think is for The Onion? You all know what The Onion is, right? That's a satirical newspaper. Anybody wanna venture a guess what that is? The Pillow Fight. Well, let's see if you're right. It looks like study links, binge eating to stress is the real one. So headlines are another part of this piece that is really interesting. I mean, the media writes a great headline. They want you to buy. They want you to subscribe. They want you to get to the other side of the paywall. They want you to pick up the newspaper. It needs to be on the top half of the fold. And so this is one of the ways that we do that, you know. So think about that, and I'm going to go into Derek's world just a little bit. He went into the echo chamber concept, and I'm going to talk a little bit about cognitive bias. The cognitive bias is that, you know, we like things sort of already chewed up and a little bit digested for ourselves first before we consume it. And so we really like things, you know, we automatically go to this place where we're simplifying information and processes and, you know, our strategies in our head. And therefore, we tend to look at information that we agree with. And we tend to look at that more and more. And as Derek said, you know, then we form this echo chamber of likeness. And so that becomes an issue for us, especially when we bump up to our friends on Facebook who suddenly have an opinion that's not yours and you're unfriending them. So that us versus them thing is something that we need to make sure that we're keeping, some awareness around. So at PSU, we spend a great deal of time with our fabulous librarians, and I think one of our librarians is here tonight with us, Alex. She helped me put a lot of this together, and we, as professors, work really hard to make sure that students are understanding what media is and what is appropriate. So we're looking to make sure that authors that we're checking to see who is the author of the publication, does the publication have a particular point of view, and does it relate to your point of view, and is who is the audience in the article, who's the audience for the article, what evidence does the author use to support that point of view, and also to ask the very important question is, when I'm reading that article, what's missing? Is it data? Is it scholarship? Is it, you know, what is it that is going to make you say, is this real or is this believable? Is this credible? And one of the things that I want to stop here and have you take in for a minute is that organizations like the Public Relations Society of America and the Society for Professional Journalists all have codes of ethics. They're trained. When, even at, you know, at universities where we're training journalists and we're training public relations people, this is something that they are educated about. And when they leave the academy, they have a code of ethics. So keep that in mind as you are also digesting media. On campus, we have something fun called the crap test. We usually march our freshmen into the library and we go over these very basic tenets for them when they're looking at resources. And it's something that we too, as consumers of media, need to be aware of, that, you know, you need to make sure that your information is timely. Is it current? Is it relevant? You know, where is the importance of the information with your needs? Is it relevant to you and to the audience? What about the authority? Who is it? Is this a credible expert that is giving this information out? Is it accurate? Is it reliable? Is it truthful and correct in its content? And then again, what's the purpose? What's the reason for the information that it exists? And so those are things that we work very hard to make sure that students and anybody else that's, you know, when you're looking at media is taking this in, and you should be thinking about the crap test. So tomorrow morning when you're looking at whatever it is that you're going to consume on your handheld device, start thinking, like, does this hold up? You know, does this meet the crap test? Which is kind of a fun thing to say to yourself at 7:30 in the morning. fact-checking, you know, there's some great fact-checking websites out there, whether it's the Washington Post or All Slides or Snopes or factcheck.org. These are terrific sites to go to. There is a professor, Melissa Zamdars, out at Merrimack College, and she's come up with basically a checklist for her students. And this is a pretty good checklist, I think, for all of us. And when you're looking at a URL online, to make sure that it's a real URL, whether it's abcnews.com, that's a legitimate site. If you're looking at it and it's got period CO or anything else after that, not so much. Don't trust that. Go back and look at what you're digesting and making sure that those URLs are appropriate and legitimate media sources. This professor has also put together, and you can see at the bottom, this comes from a Minnesota PR News website. She actually has out on the web, and it's open, a list in a Google Doc sheet of over 1,000 websites that are bogus websites. Over 1,000. So there's a lot of media out there that's not appropriate. So make sure that you're also looking at the About page on the website. This should have some critical information about vision and mission, and it should be pretty concrete information when you first read it. The other thing you can do is read comments. Often people will immediately out a source that it's not appropriate, so read those comments too. Look at the quotes in the story. See if they're actually by an expert in the field. You look at the quote and see if it's searchable. So this is sort of a great way, thing that we use in college, when you have a student who is putting something in their paper, all you need to do is type in like the first four words of the quote, and it'll come right up on Google. That's how we catch a lot of plagiarism in our world. So if you can do this, and it should take you right to the source, and Google does a great job of that. And the other thing that you can do is if you find an image that you think does not correlate with the story, then right-click on that and send it into a reverse Google search, image search. And it'll come right up. It'll come right up and tell you that, well, that was really from a movie that was shot by Spielberg, you know, 5 years ago, versus, you know, something that had to do with a recent article about, Zionists or something like that. So some takeaways, and this also goes to what Derek said, keep your emotions in check and then do some fact checking, okay, before you have, a full out kind of like, this is crazy, go check that organization and check where you're getting that information from. Also remember, perspective does not equal bias, and look for the content and substance, not on the surface. Don't just scratch it, go a little further. And then make sure that you're finding that original material that, you know, that you can go to, that you can have some clarity about. And lastly, I love that Derek brought up memes, because I have to leave you with a meme, because I have my own personal conspiracy theory that the whole internet was set up for cats, by cats, with cats. So thank you so much. A special shout out to our PSU librarians and our research coaches, because they are on our front lines of getting our students thinking critically and having that a critical analysis skills that they need to take into the world as adults. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Catherine, especially for the cat meme. Very nice. And again, please continue to eat your salads there while we await dinner, and jot down questions. Does everybody have forks? Are we good? We're going to be continue tonight with Michael Hartmann. Michael is a senior fellow and director of the Center for Strategic Giving at the Capital Research Center in Washington, D.C. He recently wrote an article in which he explored the evidence for how philanthropic support of nonprofit media skews left. For more than 18 years, he served on the program staff of the Lyndon Harry Bradley Foundation in Milwaukee, including as its director of research. He assisted Bradley's vice president for programs in administering the foundation's grant making in K through 12 education, employee rights, economic growth and prosperity, energy and the environment, law and legal reform, equal opportunity and individual liberty, and family and society. He is a past visiting fellow of the Philanthropy Roundtable in DC, where he researched and wrote Helping People to Help Themselves, a Guide for Donors. Before joining Bradley in 1998, he was a director of research at the Wisconsin Policy Research Institute. He is a graduate of the University of Minnesota Law School and has published law review articles on the constitutionality of school vouchers and aspects of welfare reform, as well as on the First Amendment and intellectual property rights. Michael.
Well, thank you for that introduction. That was, I think, permissible hyperbole, maybe, and not fake news. It would have passed the tests, I hope. That's very nice of you. Thanks as well to the Berks County Community Foundation for inviting me to participate in tonight's event. This is quite a program. I hope you certainly continue it, and I hope it's replicated, to use a philanthropic word that's used all the time, replicated elsewhere. As Karin said, I worked at the Lyndon Harry Bradley Foundation, which is in Milwaukee. I did not know when I accepted the invitation that the Brewers would be playing in Game 3 of the National League Championship Series, which I think begins at 7:40. But I'll be in the bar immediately after this and will buy a Miller Lite for anybody who joins me in rooting for them. You know, the Packers are on tonight as well, so hopefully there'll be two TVs in there. In fact, I know there are. I have checked. Miller Lite's available as well there, so that's something you can do with me. I was also able to attend a Reading Royals game last night, which was great fun. That will get me some street cred back home with my hockey fan friends. I understand it's the first game you've won of the season, and I further understand from the Reading Eagle that the victory was spurred by a decidedly uncivil fight in the first period. So we can maybe or maybe not draw a lesson from that. At the Bradley Foundation, where I did work for almost two decades, we funded research, public education, as we would call it, and then public discourse in general and specifically. It was a goal to get the people we supported into prominent newspapers, publications, on TV, before Congress to testify. So we tried to pay close attention to the flow of information. And it was changing, and changing a lot, so it presented many challenges, and we're still trying to deal, they are still trying to deal with them there. I'm not there anymore, but we who are supported by them as well, as is the Capital Research Center, are trying to deal with this changing landscape. So I have three general points, two of which I think would apply to both liberal and conservative funders and consumers of news, the third one of which might apply in particular to conservatives, this having to do with the ratio of funding of nonprofit opinion magazines. In 2006, a book caught our attention on the staff of the Bradley Foundation. It was called The Economics of Attention by a UCLA English professor, David Lanham. And it had great implications, and it sort of shook us a little bit. The point was, you know, the most precious resource in our new information economy was, in fact, not information, we're all drowning in it, but attention. And I think what everybody here in the different ways is talking about is what's being done to get your attention, which is valuable, more valuable than it used to be, given the haystack we're all in, haystack of information, opinion, analysis. Unfortunately, also sometimes including fraudulently either presented or formulated information, fake news. So, okay, the first point. Let's just do this for a foundation. I'm going to cheat a little bit, table 8 here. Can I do this? This will anger the TV people because I'm away. So the Ellerman Foundation, you want both your names in there? We'll just call it the Ellerman family. We'll call it the Ellerman Foundation. Don't say family, then the kids get a little uppity and they want to have a say. The Ellerman Foundation, let's make it worth $500,000. Not okay, that about right? Which means you have to give away about $15 million a year to retain your tax exempt status. Take off five of that because you got to give it to the museum and the zoo and so forth. There'll be pressures brought to bear on the grant making budget. So let's say, table eight, the Ellerman Foundation has $10 million a year to spend on public discourse. We will not yet assign to you a worldview. That'll be for the third point. Okay, so the Ellerman Foundation's sitting around thinking, gee, you know, we have supported a lot of people who were good at what they did and got attention for their either research or observations or insight or commentary on the Wall Street Journal op-ed page, the New York Times op-ed page. Some great opinion magazines that got attention among elites whom we're trying to influence to get certain public policies furthered. Yeah, Ellerman was pretty proud of what they did, and still are, of course. But you know, the barrier to entry for other people who want to contribute to public discourse by technology is greatly lowered, including so much so that people are now making stuff up, and they're using algorithms to get ahead of you in line in, for to get the eyes of the attention to, of everybody else in the room that you're trying to reach with your good points. What do we do? What do we, the Ellerman Foundation, do? Can I be your executive director? Because I've got some advice. I'm not cheap. Okay, and I need health care. I'm sick. Right. Given the fact that there is less value added by your grants than there used to be, because of the fact that these op-ed pages that you've relied on to get the message out are not worthless, but worth less. So there's less value added to the philanthropic dollar. This should be humbling. So I've picked table eight, and I'm telling you, be humbled. You know, drop the swagger. Quit walking around like you own the place, even though you do own and run the Ellerman Foundation. What is it we're supposed to do after being humbled? You can be looking forward now to how to handle this change in circumstance. Well, how's this for a good executive director thing to say? Let's be more strategic, which means pick better, do more with less, or try to. The flip side of that is maybe we'll be more lucky. And I mean, I'm genuine about that. Strategic and lucky are, maybe sometimes they go together. We can look for more funding allies for what it is we're trying to put out. And that is not uncommon. The Koch Foundation has a network. They convene people where they share whom they fund and urge others to join them. The Democracy Alliance on what I'll call the liberal side, funded by George Soros, does the same thing. We can double down. We can spend more money. We can go into the endowment if things are so important. This would be something you would want to consider doing. Nor would it be unreasonable to conclude in this context, maybe we should cede the field and get out of public discourse and pick other areas. There's no shortage of people making good arguments for philanthropic investment by the Ellerman Foundation. And maybe, given the way this has changed so much, we should get out of this and pick another worthy area in which to invest, lower hanging fruit. All right, so that's first point, less value added, which should humble us. And I think four not really very good options from your executive director about what to do next, but best I can do for now. Second quick point, I think probably easily made after hearing what we already have. Lies spread faster than the truth. This has always been the case, as we all know, but the technology, of course, now I think means that lies spread even faster than they used to, than the truth. And this is bad for public discourse in general. The public discourse in which we all want to participate, you know, liberals and conservatives and libertarians and progressives and everybody, it's bad overall, and it's bad specifically if you have one of those worldviews because it might detract from your credibility as well or in particular, given on which lies are being spread and what's being found out about how the lies are spread and who's spreading them and how you can categorize who's the liar and who's the spreader and so forth. All right, so the Ellerman Foundation needs to be humbled. Again, it's even harder to do what we wanted to do given both of those points, less value added from your millions, lies spread faster than the truth as it's trying to be spread by your grant making. Okay, so again, after humbling the money holder, the funder, we can be more strategic or lucky again. We can look for more allies, double down, go into the seed corn, or seed the field. Now, unfairly, Ellerman Foundation, if I can assign to you something to which you might not subscribe at all, for all I know, let's pretend it's a conservative foundation and look at some numbers in the nonprofit opinion journalism world. The Shorenstein Center for Media, Politics, and Public Policy and Northeastern University School of Journalism recently released a pretty major study of nonprofit journalism writ large, but it had a section in there on magazines, which I just want to highlight for my employers at the Ellerman Foundation. A team of researchers, there was a big team, it was a big study, they analyzed more than 32,000 foundation grants from 2010 to 2015 in support of nonprofit journalism. Collectively, these totaled about $1.8 billion. All of these numbers are relative, but that's a lot of money. Over 6 years, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Of the $1.8 billion, a little more than $80 million went to magazines, so about 5% of the total. Of this, about $29.3 million went to magazines that the team felt they could categorize as either liberal or conservative. So that's just one note here in my, not cynicism, but maybe skepticism. They had another category for general interest, which some conservatives might have said it includes liberal magazines. The Atlantic was one of them. But okay, let's go with Harper's was another. Let's go with the categories of the study. 29.3 to magazines that can be categorized. Of the 29.3, $22.8 million went to nine liberal magazines. So that's 77.8%. 6.5 million went to five conservative magazines, about 22.2%. So that's a 3.5-to-1 ratio in favor of liberal opinion magazines, not in the nonprofit. Most of them are nonprofit, and that's the ratio. So the Ellerman Foundation, we've got another challenge if we want to be a conservative foundation, whether you are or not, and participate in this enterprise. One note about the ratio before I get to an appendix, I want to list the magazines for you so you can all see if you subscribe. You know, that three plus, more than 3-to-1 liberal to conservative ratio is found in other contexts. It's not surprising to me, or I don't think would be surprising to many development directors at conservative nonprofits. A study earlier in the year found a 3.4-to-1, this is not in nonprofit journalism, just overall a 3.4-to-1 liberal to conservative advantage in the total revenues of all policy-oriented nonprofits in the 501c3 space that were supported by six top liberal and six top conservative foundations. A Manhattan Institute study last year found a 3.3-to-1 liberal to conservative advantage in grant spending by 28 top liberal and 24 top conservative policy-oriented foundations. So, you know, if it were the case that somebody might have thought, the market is killing off all these journalism outfits because they can't survive and aren't good, and it'd be healthy if foundations were the ones that had to come in and save journalism. If you're a conservative foundation, you might just want to know or note to yourself, ourselves at the Ellerman Foundation, that you're going to be at a disadvantage there, just which means you've got to either be, again, more strategic, more humble about what you're going to be up to, or find more funding allies if it's the case that you want to outraise, outspend your liberal counterparts. Or you can double down, thinking it's a sort of revolutionary time, go into your seed corn. Some foundations do that. They spend out in a certain period of time to prevent the kids from fighting over it later, or the staffs from taking it. Or you could seed the field and look elsewhere for your philanthropic investments, whatever that might be, you know, higher education or civic education, or there'd be no shortage of alternatives. So that's three quick points, each of which is humbling. At the end of one of the articles, I guess it was the one referenced in the introduction on the nonprofit magazines, I did sort of offer some advice about, I said seeding the field would be a mistake at this time. This is a point I think as well that it would apply to both liberal and conservative foundations. You know, don't give up on opinion journalism or to-ing and fro-ing on paper with facts and analysis and argument because of the benefits it has internally. You'll have a better conservatism resulting from that kind of disagreement over time. Would have been helpful maybe to have had some of that before the current mess we're in. I think as well on the liberal side, it's a period of time during which it would be helpful to have that sort of healthy, vigorous disagreement slash discussion. Given the trauma, T-R-A-U-M-A, and drama of 2016 and its aftermath. So I hope I didn't take up too much of your time, and I'm looking forward to the other presentations. Thanks.
Thank you, Michael. Bala Peterson is our next speaker tonight. Bala is the chair of the board of BCTV, and thank you for your commitment to consider it as well. I know this will be broadcast, I believe, at a later date at some point. So if you missed it, you want to revisit it or tell your friends about it, you'll be able to catch it on BCTV. It's a nonprofit media provider here in Berks County, and he's also founder of Cast and Crew Digital, a technology consulting and marketing firm based in Reading. He is passionate about narrative-based marketing and storytelling. His experience as a computer scientist affords him the opportunity to tackle software development and other technical challenges. He served in previous technical and product development roles at Santander, formerly Sovereign Bank, and Comcast Interactive Media. He holds a bachelor's degree in computer science from Kutztown University, a master's in project management from Boston University. He was born in Nigeria, raised in the Netherlands, and currently lives right here with us in Reading.
Thank you, everyone, for having me. I want to meet the guy that she just introduced. So my job here is simply to create awareness. I'm not here to give you hope or just to tell you what's going on, okay? My perspective is a little different. I am a technologist first. I was a marketer for a long time. So whenever you see these ads or things that interrupt you, usually it's my fault. So here we go. Technology is moving really quickly. A lot of great things coming up. One indicator we use to help understand it, all technology expands or extends current human capacity. Okay? So what does that mean? So this microphone extends my voice, allows me to speak to you a little clearer, and if I get in my car, I can move a little faster than if I walk. My job is to explain how the algorithms work, but it's important to just, we have a very diverse crowd, so I'm just going to simplify it by saying algorithms are simply the rules. So Catherine talked about the crap test. That is an algorithm. Right? That is a set of rules by which she determines if something is legitimate or not. And it's possible to actually write code to automate that for you, but it's going to fail at a certain point, and I'll explain that in a second. So, technology that expands current human capacity. For this talk, I'm going to focus on Facebook and Google, okay? So, in the beginning, this town square concept, and then the library concept. So the innovation there was, we're gonna build a set of crawlers that will go across the entire internet, and you present text, and we'll match it for you. Facebook, the innovation there is that in real time, they're able to gather all of this information and show it to you. And in the beginning, the algorithms were simple. It was simple, as for Facebook, it was chronological. And for Google, they would simply match the text. And if two results matched, they would pick proximity or they would pick volume, how many sites linked to this result. Basic algorithms. But if the sound guy back there doesn't tune this microphone correctly, there will be feedback. And we see that with all technology. No, please don't create feedback, right? And you know, with automobiles, it's traffic, it is pollution, it is all those good things. And so what we're seeing is we're getting some feedback with these algorithms, because once commerce is introduced to the mix, because these entities have to make money, it is very, very expensive to do the work they're doing, so they get funding. And so Facebook stops becoming this town square concept, and they become property managers, where each of you are the product. Like, if you're not paying for it, your attention is the product. So if Facebook does a great job, they'll be thriving as an entity. But if they do a poor job, no one goes there anymore. The advertisers leave or the vendors leave. And Google is interesting because they still do a really great job, but they're just so saturated with advertising that sometimes it feels irrelevant with the results. So those are just two examples of algorithms going bad. And each of these property managers, they adjust the algorithms. So, what can a robot do right now? Now, some of this technology is really old. It's not new, but there are new ways to repurpose them. So, Catherine's crap algorithm. A computer, it's very difficult for a computer to say true or false, to determine the factuality of something. But what they can tell you is how sad, how much joy, how much fear does a body of text represent. They will be able to tell you on a range from 1 to 20 the intensity of the joy expressed in the article. They will be able to tell you how positive, how negative an article is. And anything that falls in the middle is seen as neutral. Now, as an engineer, if my audience says, hey, the articles in this place are too negative, what I can do is I can tweak that ratio, the score, and I can say any post that usually falls in the middle, but people still feel it's too negative, I can tweak these values to get anger better defined. Okay, let's move on. Let me give you an example. So, I became an American 3 years ago. Yay, America. Come on. Come on. All right. So, the challenge, though, around that time is like you have to take this test. And I'm awful at tests. So, what I did is started to Google, started to study. And what ends up happening is that I took the Declaration of Independence and I ran it through some sentiment analysis just to understand how these different platforms are categorizing bodies of texts. And to be a little sensationalistic for this talk, I also took the oath to Adolf Hitler to see what the computer thinks about this body of text. Unfortunately, if you look at some of the metrics, they're properly categorized, right? So it says this body of text is about law, government, politics, and so on and so forth. But then when I ran it through sentiment analysis, what we start to see is that the sentiment in the Declaration of Independence, the ratios match this very fascist document. The ratios of joy, anger, disgust, sadness, all of those ratios match. So if I click on the Declaration of Independence, Google says, ah, I have a picture of Bala Peterson. And it starts to serve me content that matches these ratios. If I click an ad next to the search result, it says, ah, I'm starting to understand how much content and what Bala's content consumption looks like. So it builds a profile of me. So a couple of things that are really, really frustrating. Because of this profile that I have, Google or Facebook says, Bala buys ads. Bala is married to Lali. And what we're going to do is, because Bala loves this content, we're going to show Lali the same content. No, no, no. They show Lali the content that matches the same profile. The scary part about this is that I have two boys, they're 8 and 9, and YouTube is a thing. So if my family profile is based off of my consumption as the spender in the family, my kids could potentially be shown crazy fascist content that I have nothing about based off of our families' profiles. That's something that we should all be worried about. Just say. Okay, so what does this mean in general? I believe Catherine talked about culture. Robots will start to determine culture because content is going to be filtered based off of, hey, what content consumption pattern leads to ads being bought? So the more ads that you buy, the more of a profile they're building of you. And that should be disturbing, and that should be exciting as well. So another point I just want to make really quickly is that most articles have their ratios, but it's rare that you will find very polarizing ratios. Artificial intelligence does not, the way artificial intelligence is currently tuned is to be as middle ground as possible. So I could use the word hate and it wouldn't give me a disgust of 9. It will only return disgust at a level of 7 or maybe 6, depending on the platform. And so the reason why this matters is because we are all beholden to these for-profit entities. And depending on how they lean, liberal or conservative, these numbers change. The pause was for effect. Because when Zuckerberg has to go to Congress, right afterwards, they tweak the algorithms so things are more pleasant. Okay. Answers, how I consume the internet. So I actually enjoy Facebook. I think it's kind of funny. And I train the ads. So if I like something, I tell it, I like this thing. Okay? But if I'm looking for news or insight, I go to Reddit. Reddit is a place where I can upvote something that's legitimate and it's more topical, right? And it's groups of people. So if a revolution wanted to be had in America, I think it will start at Reddit. Because you'll have people talking about real issues and there's less noise. Although Reddit is for profit, so that's a thing. Another solution that I think that's important is what Amazon is doing. I go on, so $1 out of every $2 is spent online is spent on Amazon. I love their recommendations engine, so I want them to know everything possible about me, right? Because their stated purpose is clear for me to purchase. And I'm the chair of BCTV, but I think that local community media is really, really important. If I have an issue with something that Commissioner Leinbach said, I can walk up to him and have a conversation. We have to invest and promote local media. I don't mean to steal some of the thunder. And local media is important. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Bala. Okay, our last speaker, as you begin to have your dinner this evening, we'll join you in just a few moments, is Nina Sachdev. Nina is the communications director at Media Impact Funders, a Philadelphia-based member-supported network of funders who seek to improve society through media and technology. She spent a decade as a journalist at the Dallas Morning News, the Press Democrat in Santa Rosa, California, the Philadelphia Daily News, and Philadelphia Weekly. She's the creator and co-editor of the award-winning The Survivors Project, Telling the Truth About Life After Sexual Abuse, a book-length work of nonfiction that utilizes first-person storytelling to address the reality of healing from the effects of sexual abuse. Nina holds a master's in journalism from Temple University. Nina?
Thank you. Bala said that he wasn't going to leave you with hope, but as the last speaker, I'm feeling a lot of pressure to leave you with hope. So we're all leaving with hope. Our glasses are going to be half full. Awesome. So I want to start off tonight with a pretty famous quote, I'm sure you've heard it before, from an equally famous person. Perception is reality. My dad said that. He said that many times. every time I would ask him a question, Dad, why do people think this way or do these things? Well, perception is reality, honey. Okay, so maybe you don't know him, but this idea that our behaviors influence what others believe, it's like marketing 101, right? So it's as old as time. But the reason I'm interested in this is because as we grapple with rapidly spreading disinformation that causes confusion about who and what to trust, it's becoming more and more scary to see what others perceive as real. So last week I was at a film festival dedicated to highlighting investigative reporting documentaries. And I watched a short film called Our New President, and I could not get my dad's words of wisdom out of my head. This short film, This short film is essentially the story of Donald Trump's election told entirely through Russian propaganda. When the film first premiered, the filmmaker was quoted as saying, "We wanted to see if it was possible to make a documentary out of news without a single true statement in it." So I want to show you just a few minutes of the opening scene so you can get a feel for the kinds of stories that Russians were consuming around 2016.
Американец. Трамп, brother, good job, man. Donald Trump. Если ты смотришь это видео, а я уверен, что ты это делаешь, я хочу тебя поздравить с победой.
Запи свою песню американскому президенту Трампу.
Рязани может появиться улица имени Дональда Трампа. Рязанцы хотят переименовать улицу с недвусмысленным названием «Вторая безбожная». Название не соответствует российским ценностям, оскорбляет религиозное чувство верующих.
Российский ученый Александр Нелогов из Абакана утверждает, что новоизбранный президент США ни много ни мало потомок основателя государства российского.
Okay, you should definitely watch the rest of this film. It's only 11 minutes long. But the reason is because it's important to see what can happen in the absence of a free and independent fourth estate. And that's what I want to talk to you about today: journalism, democracy, and philanthropy. I want to start off by pulling back the curtain a little bit on what we do and what our funders do, because much of philanthropy really is a mystery to everyday citizens. Some of this is by design, because in the media space, there's a strict firewall that we need to maintain. Funders of media, and I'm talking specifically about journalism here, understand that any perception of influence taints their investment. And by the way, funders and nonprofit news sites also now have their own code of ethics, which is exciting. So Media Impact Funders is a network of funders who support media to advance issues that are critical to the public interest. And when I say public interest, I mean any issue that we all care about: health, environment, economic progress, anything. But when I say media, I mean more than just newspapers. Support for media today takes so many forms, including documentary film, mobile phone apps, advocacy campaigns, immersive technologies like VR and AR, media policy, and infrastructure. Okay, so now that I've given that context, I want to give you the gist of my talk, which is journalism is in crisis. This has had very serious consequences for our democracy. But the bright spot is that philanthropy is stepping up to address these challenges in a variety of ways. So let's start with the one that most of us are already aware of, which is journalism is struggling. Across the country, newsrooms are shrinking and closing down in the face of economic and technological challenges that have absolutely crippled the news industry. Our friends at Shorenstein, which Michael referenced earlier, recently conducted a comprehensive survey of philanthropic support for the news, and I won't reread any of the statistics that Michael provided, but I will add some interesting context that they gave us. Jobs in the U.S. steel industry declined 64% over 35 years. Jobs at U.S. newspapers declined 58% over just 15 years. So communities across the U.S. are dealing with a severe decline, and in some cases, total elimination of local news. Consumers' habits have changed significantly too, moving from a reliance on print and broadcast to online and mobile, shifting news shared by friends and peers rather than directly from original content producers. Adding to this crisis is the fact that the press is under attack in unprecedented ways. When the president repeatedly calls the press the enemy of the people, or when the administration or politicians or anyone labels news it doesn't like as fake news, this contributes to the increasing levels of doubt and mistrust in the public square. And when we talk about trust, I think it's important for us to talk about whose trust. The Poynter Institute released a survey last year examining trust in the media and found that 1 year into the Trump administration, Democrats trust the media more and Republicans trust it less. And the rhetoric that the president has used against the press has really sunk in. A large majority of Trump supporters agree with his description that the press is the enemy of the people and agree that the government should be able to block news stories it does not like. So these findings are in part related to the echo chamber conversation that Derek talked about earlier. The survey also found that 44% of people believe that the press is making up stories. So nearly half of America thinks that we're making things up. I think regardless of what side you are on, we can agree that these findings are very troubling. Trust should not be partisan. So, the state of journalism has had a lot of consequences for our democracy. When news organizations falter, and when there aren't reporters in the places where they need to be, issues at the center of civic life, education, environment, health, they all receive less independent scrutiny from journalists, and citizens have less access to the information they need to engage effectively in their own communities. At the same time, misleading or false stories masquerading as news have proliferated across the ecosystem, which is a word we like to use in philanthropy, undermining public trust in reliable journalism, exploiting the information vacuum left by shrinking news operations, and disrupting civic dialogue. And going back to Michael's talk, the Ellerman Foundation should absolutely consider or absolutely continue funding public discourse initiatives. We need more conservative voices in the ecosystem. So, all that being said, this isn't, like I said before, this is going to be about hope. This isn't a doom and gloom presentation. There is a huge bright spot, and that is that philanthropy is providing support for a free press at a critical moment in our nation's history. See, look, the suns. I don't have cat memes, but I have suns. So the field of media and philanthropy is constantly growing. Worldwide, foundations have invested more than $11 billion in media since 2009. That support comes in a variety of ways, way too many to name here, but I want to call out a few examples of how funders are finding solutions. And we'll start with how they're combating misinformation because it's so relevant to tonight's discussion. Many in philanthropy are trying to understand how to mitigate the effects of misinformation, disinformation, and propaganda. Notice how I'm taking the time to call all of these out individually instead of using this catch-all term, fake news, which I find problematic, and I want to talk to Catherine about it afterward. Philanthropic initiatives seek to intervene at one of three points on the information system: the production of news, the distribution of news, and the consumption of news. Most philanthropic initiatives are aimed at the production of news, as in more and better quality journalism, or the consumption of news, such as bolstering fact-checking operations and efforts to promote media literacy. Less is known about the role that online platforms play in distributing information, probably because we're talking about commercial platforms that do not need to open their doors to us. Hopefully that changes soon, because Facebook recently announced that it would give a committee of scholars funded by the Hewlett Foundation and others in philanthropy access to some of its proprietary data, because we need to understand how it works. Strengthening local news. This is the favorite part of my talk, because I believe so strongly and fiercely in local news. As important as these and other national funding efforts are, local and regional funders have a unique capacity to complement these efforts by supporting the creation of media that engages local communities and elevates local voices. This connection that we have is lost. So one way in which funders are trying to bolster local news is NewsMatch. It's an innovative matching gift campaign that raises money for nonprofit newsrooms around the country. It has engaged tens of thousands of new donors to nonprofit journalism, including place-based and community foundations who can really make a difference on the local level. Funders are finding other innovative strategies to help support local reporting, and I'll share with you one of my favorite examples. In Flint, Michigan, reports of unsafe drinking water had been ignored for years. The ACLU of Michigan, which was at the forefront of the effort to bring these issues to light but could not for some reason, was banging its head against the wall until the Ford Foundation responded with a strategy that had never been used before. Ford funded the hiring of an investigative reporter at the ACLU, the first time a foundation grant was ever directed to the hiring of such a journalistic position at a nonprofit. That foundation-funded reporter, Kurt Guyette, was the journalist who broke the story and uncovered the national scandal. So what I want you to walk away with tonight is that quality media and journalism does make a difference no matter what political party you are affiliated with, and it can have a positive impact on public debate. I want to share one last clip. It's an audio clip, and it's of a little girl who was separated by her parents at the border this past summer. This is audio obtained by ProPublica, a nonprofit a Pulitzer Prize-winning nonprofit investigative reporting outlet, supported by a number of philanthropies, some of which I've named tonight. This clip is going to be very difficult to hear, but it's important for us to hear it, because this clip is not perception. This is reality. I've listened to this clip many times, and it does not get any easier, especially when you see those two comments at the end. But, you know, it's journalism like this that provides a real face to contentious policy debates. And now more than ever, funders across the country are repositioning quality journalism as a central pillar of American democracy, because the role of journalism has never been so uncertain nor so deeply vital. Thank you.
Thank you, Nina, and thank you to all our panelists. We will have dinner with you now. Remember to please fill out your questionnaires, and then we will begin our Q&A portion of the event tonight around 7:30. Bon appétit. Good evening. Good evening. If you could all take your seats, we're going to get started with the Q&A portion of the event tonight. Hopefully you had some great dinner conversation. Can you hear me with this microphone? Is it clear? Excellent. Okay, everybody ready for the questions? We're going to begin with Derek with a question that is pointed for you. What might a balanced plate of news look like? I already rely on NPR.
Traditionally, NPR is one of the better, typically seen as more mainstream and yet balanced as well. One of the things I would actually recommend, and it will take a little bit of doing, knowing that, again, every news agency and source is going to be, they're going to have an agenda. There's just not a particular group, at least of the main ones, that is just going to say, here's the news, here's the facts. Because even if they do that, you're going to have stories that don't get told because they choose them based on the time they have or kind of their own interests. One thing I would consider folks to think about is perhaps look at even news sources outside of the country. They will have their own particular kind of agendas as well, but in some cases, I think it's neat to be able to look at what things they do pay attention to, because in some cases, they will supplement what we hear in our country. And in some cases, it's nice just to take a step back and take a little perspective of what are other people thinking about. We are just so connected with other countries economically and in many other ways as well, more and more. So I think it's important to be able to just look at the possibilities that are out there and, you know, choose stuff, try stuff, and if you don't like it, you can always move, but, you know, as far as into a different source. But I think it's always a good thing to try to be aware of your opportunities and possibilities as part of that.
Can I add something to that?
Absolutely.
The survey that I mentioned earlier from the Poynter Institute showed that PBS actually is the number one most trusted news site in the U.S. Philanthropically supported.
This next question is for Bala. Bala, should news-related algorithms be controlled, and by whom?
Should news-related algorithms be controlled, and by whom? What are we talking about? Are we talking about fact, insight, editorial, advertising, or entertainment? Like, all of those carry different registries as far as algorithms are concerned. It's possible for it to be controlled on an individual basis, but it should be controlled by an individual. Because I have my recipe, which includes the sentiment that I'm looking for, the intensity of emotion, and I think Facebook has the opportunity for me to curate my algorithm for the news I see. So yes, by an individual, to answer your question. Does that answer the question?
I believe so. I didn't write it, but I hope so.
But it should not be controlled by government.
Let me ask you this, because this kind of goes along with that same question. Is it possible to create an algorithm that cannot understand lies?
Is it possible to create an algorithm that cannot understand lies? So it is not possible, because a lie is a mixture of truth, and falsehood, right? So if we're going to think about it algorithmically, you'd have to, so I talked about the scores and the ratios. So how much of truth versus, how much of fact versus infactual do you consider a lie, right? So it, no. No.
Thank you.
Okay.
This question is for Catherine. Where do you get your news, find trustworthy?
So I blow my students away every semester in my PR class, and I tell them that I spend about 2 hours a day on my reads. Now, reads is sort of slang for reading with the students. So my reads are like 2 hours a day, dude. And they're like, whoa, crazy. I read everything. I hit the door at 7:30 in the morning. I grab the Reading Eagle and the New York Times. I have the Wall Street Journal on my phone and a subscription to that. And then I will sort of peruse what's interesting. I'll hit my financial news because that's my jam. And so I look at everything, and if I'm looking at a particular issue, something that is very salient to me, then I will go deep dive on that. I will go to various articles and various writers to see what they're saying about a particular issue. And it may take me a couple of days before I can really form a decent conclusion about that. So I'll go deep. I may watch an in-depth, whether it's a documentary or whether it's, you know, something a little deeper. I try not to rush to judgment on anything. And being a PR person, you know, you have to understand that 85% of what you see in the news is fed to journalists because there's not enough journalists. And it's getting better for PR people and less good for journalists. And we need good journalists. We in the PR world support good journalism. We have our role is to provide a fact. I actually tell my students that, by the way, a press release is a memo to the media. It's not a story, it's a memorandum to the media. That's what we're writing. When we write a press release, it is a memo. So as if you were in your company writing a memo to the operations director or the marketing director, it's a memorandum. That's what you're doing. Only you're sending it out to a journalist and you're disseminating it. So keep that in mind when you think about that in terms of disseminating information and what you're doing and how you're reading your information. So back to my comment about journalists. We love journalists. We want journalists to survive and thrive. And finding good writers is important. You don't have to agree with the topic. My suggestion is go find somebody who writes well, who makes you think, who can put a sentence together, who is very good at the craft of writing and writing well.
And this question is for Michael. Are there more liberal journalism nonprofits which could explain the ratio imbalance? Isn't the universe of journalists more left-leaning?
Yeah, that might be, yes. I don't know that to be the case. I think it might be the case. I couldn't prove it to myself. But I think if there was, you know, there's probably some survey of journalism professors and with their partisan affiliate. But I think it's probably the case that more young people who go into journalism are going to be liberal than conservative. But you know, there's attempts, philanthropic attempts, to try to alter that a little bit with training programs to encourage, you know, conservatives to think about journalism. And then there'll be a fellowship program you might get at some nonprofit or something. But my direct answer to the question, without having any facts to back it up, is I think it might be the case, yes, that there are more. It might be more of a cooler thing to do, that there might be more receptivity on the part of youth to pursue a journalism career than not, which shouldn't be the case. I worked at the Minnesota Daily, college, one of the largest college newspapers in the country, but I think more people should consider going into journalism.
This question is for Nina. How can we cultivate more interest in local news at a time when people cannot take their attention off Washington?
Yeah, trickle-down Trump is a big issue. He dominates the news cycle. I think, you know, when I was talking about Newsmatch, the point that I wanted to make that I didn't was that we need to start thinking about news as something that we need, that we are responsible for as the people. When we donate to campaigns like ending poverty or hunger, or donating our blood to the Red Cross, like donating to the news and supporting the news needs to be everybody's problem and everybody's solution. So that's kind of a like hippy-dippy answer to your question, but I just think we need collectively to care about reporting more than we do, because we've grown so accustomed to the advertising model, but that has collapsed. And digital startups are struggling to find working business models, and I think like we are the model. We need to pay the people to represent us. That's my answer.
Go ahead, Bala.
If I contribute, I think people don't understand the seriousness, the importance of good local news. So like First Amendment is freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of to gather, freedom of press. That falls. Like these are all pillars that need to stand up this thing that we call America. And if one of those falls, then
we're left limping. And then you can't petition government properly because not enough people are informed. That's why people are not voting. So I don't think people understand the seriousness of how important it is to get good local news so that we can challenge City Hall, so that we can challenge the commissioners. And that's the problem. It's just everyone's just lackadaisical about it. And
this next question is for any panelists, so feel free to jump in. Comment about the censorship of Alex Jones, InfoWars by Apple, et cetera. Is this a slippery slope? Anybody want to tackle?
I feel strongly about this. I think it is a slippery slope, yes. I think it, so if the next revolution in America is about to happen, where does it happen? So these for-profit entities are, yes, it's crazy, but just like I showed, the registry for crazy, and so I believe in Jesus and I love God, the registry for crazy and the gospel are identical. So it's absolutely a slippery slope, and sorry, I haven't fully formed the answer, but yes, I think it's bad.
Derek.
Yeah, thank you. I totally agree that it is a slippery slope. It is something that, you know, when I talk to my class in the conspiracy theory class and they say, oh my gosh, did you hear such and such? And people want to dismiss it kind of right away. But like, you know, Nina was saying, it's important to be able to give stuff its due judgment, you know, and the process about how to make something like that really, you know, in the end, if you decide, okay, this does not work, then I think you can dismiss it. But to have the ability to at least the opportunities for even sides that you don't agree with, even arguments that you kind of don't like, the fact that they're there won't go away. So to some extent, I think it's important that they have that ability. Now there is, I mean, look at the First Amendment. There is a particular issue when I teach a communication law class. We talk about when you can go too far, but unless you're inciting violence at that moment, unless you're asking people to break a law, then I think almost anything else should kind of go. And, you know, Winston Churchill used to say, you know, jaw, jaw, jaw is better than war, war, war. And in the end, it's important to have folks be able to express themselves. And like Bala said, it's part of what we are. And I think you have to have that.
This question is also for any panelists. How do you feel about people in the community taking news into their own hands, like bloggers doing their own research for stories without formal education, this idea of citizen journalism?
Well, Catherine. I'll give you a great example of citizen journalism early on. You all remember when that airplane landed in the Hudson River? Somebody took out their flip phone, that's how long ago that was, to remind you all, and took a picture. Bam, and it went up, you know, onto the web, and that is citizen journalism at its best. And then the AP immediately figured out who that person was, bought the photo, and then it ran everywhere that next day. And so there's that. I'm going to leave that, the second half of that answer, to one of my colleagues.
I think citizen journalism has pros and cons, but I think it raises another question, which is, I think some people in their communities are taking these issues up themselves because they feel like they're not being represented and they're not being listened to. And so, you know, because of the crisis that I talked about in journalism, you know, there are a lot of local papers doing really good work. I don't want my remarks today to be misconstrued as me beating down local journalism. But I think that there are papers that are struggling to listen to communities that are traditionally marginalized. And so we need to rekindle that connection. Journalists need to do more than just write and report. They need to listen.
And so, I mean, there will always be bloggers, and I think, you know, they need to do their due diligence in fact-checking their stories, and you know, you don't have to have formal training to be a journalist. That's the beauty of being a journalist. But I think the key thing here is that newsrooms are not listening as well as they need to be. And that was exposed in the election, right? I mean, there was so much coverage on the coast, but none in the middle.
I think there's a place for citizen journalism. And so, like, what is an so if you look at the paper, there are these op-eds that are totally like someone's opinion. I think there is, hey, y'all, this is what happened and this is what I think about it. I think we should just take it for what it is. I think we need like all the voices we can get. I think the journalism tag comes when there's an institution that needs to sustain its credibility. So you go through the process. But I think just take it for what it is, just appreciate it. And so I have no problem with citizen journalism.
Bala, this is directed to you, but please feel free to jump in when you are finished. What is the GDPR and how does it affect the privacy of companies inside and outside of the European Union?
Does it say who asked that question?
It does not.
So
these are anonymous questions.
So the GDPR is the General Data Protection Regulation. It's just a regulation that was passed in what was the European Union. And it says, so there are a couple of tenets. It says, hey, platform, what do you know about me? So all the data that you have about me as an individual, I can request that information and inspect it, and they have to comply. The second part of it says, I would like to be forgotten. So everything you know about me, delete it. And so legally, they're obligated to do that. And thirdly, do not track me. So that's huge, because a lot of the challenges that we have around clickbait. So clickbait only works because they know all this rich information about me. But if they don't, then I can get a more objective internet. And so that's the regulation that has passed in Europe, and I think it should pass here, because now if I want to opt out from the commercial part of Facebook or even my Google searches, like, they're legally obligated to comply. I wish the US would pass something like that, because I think we'll start to get just a more humane internet. That's GDPR.
Bala, this one's for you too. Is it possible to see what my neighbor in quotes, is reading or consuming online?
Not in your regulatory regime, it won't be.
Right, so the challenge is that Michael is reading all this crazy stuff, and I don't know, and he's my friend. And if I knew that, I'd unfriend him. Right. So I think there's an opportunity. There isn't a way to directly see that. There is. I think that would be cool, though, to impersonate someone in a non-invasive way. So, like, a guy who wears brown shoes and a brown tie. Like, what does their internet searches look like? I think that would help leadership, right? To see what the sentiment on the internet. Just, I feel like it could be more empathetic without being creepy.
Fine line.
It's a fine line.
Very fine line. This one probably would be for you too, Bala, but I'll open it for anyone. What tips do you have to help people, Catherine, perhaps you as well, to help people browse the internet without being tracked or without being served information based on their preferences?
There are some apps that you can use. One is Ghostly. You're gonna have to fill me in on Ghostly. There's a couple of apps that you can actually use to kind of not leave a trail of where you go. The problem is that if you ever want to buy Bruce Springsteen tickets really quickly, you have to like undo all of this stuff, and then all the tickets are sold. That didn't really happen to me.
But it might have.
Might have happened to me. The other thing is there are some Google search engines that are DuckDuckGo.
DuckDuckGo is one. The simplest way is go on Chrome and go on incognito mode.
Right.
It's a tough word. But if you really want to be anonymous, there's this thing called Tor, T-O-R. It's fantastic. Not in the creepy way, but it's like a VPN client that runs on your computer. Because like anonymity on online is not just the username and password, it's your IP. There's so many factors. And Tor completely strips it. If you're a reporter, you want to do research, and you want to, it's tor.org, and you want to really get non-personalized results, I would highly recommend Tor. And that's one real way. So the simplest way is just incognito mode in Chrome, and Tor is another powerful tool.
What do you think about apps like Ghostly and stuff like that, other than the fact that they clog up the works?
So look at who is funding it. So Tor is perfectly nonprofit, open source, supported by the community. I think though, I'm not sure about Ghostly, but they just raised funds.
Okay.
So once they do that, they're beholden to their investors. And again, if you're not paying for it, you're the product, and they absolutely sell that.
Got it.
Promise.
Good points.
A tip from a travel agent is when you're searching for a flight to go on incognito, and your flight fares will be a bit lower.
Yep.
Whoa.
Especially
lower.
if you do more than one search.
Worth the price of admission.
Because they know you want it.
They know you want the seat. All right, so that's all we have in terms of question and answers, but I would love to give each one of you a moment for a final thought. I think we have about enough time for everyone to go about 2 minutes, so I'll set the timer for you, and I'll wrap you when you hit your 2 minutes. But just some final thoughts, some things perhaps that you gained from the dinner conversation tonight. We're going to go in reverse order. So Nina, we'll start with you.
Well, I'm going to be super easy because I went last, so I gave it all away, guys. I gave my final thoughts already. I just think, I think that this is a diverse group of people, and the thing that I wanted to get across was that it shouldn't matter who you are, what you believe in, who you voted for. The point is that quality journalism is so essential. It's been essential, and it will continue to be essential, and we need to be responsible for its success, because philanthropy, I think, is not the lasting solution. I think we are.
So I guess my final thought is, so I was born in Nigeria, and I grew up in the Netherlands, and so when you tuned on to American television at night over there, you saw Jerry Springer. And that was, you know, no one would stay up to see the real content, right? That was your perception of America. And just maybe a sobering thought is that there's a whole culture, there are millions of people who are coming online for the first time on a smartphone, and their perception of the republic, and their perception of democracy, and their perception of America is the sensationalist stuff. Yeah, I'm worried about my kids and how they consume media, but the world will be shaped by these robots, and the rest of the world will think something of us
that it's not going to be helpful. So thank you. Your note? I'm sorry, I don't mean to say it like that.
Weren't you the glass half full? Or maybe that was you.
But I think this, no, this is, that's why this is so important. I think, you know, the First Amendment is so important because we have a blueprint to address these things and speech and, well, freedom of religion and thought, speech and press is so important because that's what we're exporting. Hollywood should not be our primary export. And so this is so important. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael.
So I don't know if I'm going to take 2 minutes either. The Brewers game is on. But I would say my final word would be essentially what my final word was at the podium as well. But be humble in the face of this information haystack. Be properly, really intimidated by it. As either a funder or a consumer or both, which means expose yourself to or consume as much of it as you can. Do not get caught in a bubble. That's an obvious risk, whatever the bubble might be. And as you consume as much as you can, given your time and circumstance, question all of it and constantly.
Awesome. Catherine.
Thank you. My final thought is particularly about local journalism, and I think this is imperative. And I mentioned this at the table I was sitting at. You know, we may be up here on a federal level, international level, like, oh my God, oh my God. But down here on a local level, you know, where we need to be good citizens and paying attention to what's going on a local level, like our township meetings, our county meetings, and all of that. Because if local news goes out of business, the local graph will be huge. I mean, there will be plenty of hands in the cookie jar. You won't have to worry about why, you know, $100,000 is missing in the firehouse kitty or this or that. That's what's gonna happen, because the folks that actually go to those meetings, I wish it was all of us. I wish it was me. I go when something's really erupting in my community, and that's bad on me. That's not good citizenship. But we need those local reporters to go, find out what's going on, and come back and report on it. And that's not partisan. That is like, hey, Joe's running the township, and there's money missing, or we want to put in a new bridge down the street. There's no Democrat, blue, or red in that whole statement. It's vital information to the everyday going on in our local communities, and I think that's important. So, you know, subscribe, get the news, be a part of the community, and be absolutely you know, fervent in how you're dissecting and digesting your news on a upper level, on a federal level and an international level. But the stuff that's going on that's really going to hit you hard is going to be in your own backyard.
Derek?
When we were talking before we came out on stage for the first time, we were just kind of talking about some of the things that we were going to speak about in a way. And somebody at some point said, kind of just referred to this time as a hot mess. I don't know if it's the academic term or whatever, but hot mess I liked. Because on one hand, it makes us kind of almost shrug our shoulders and goes, what's possibly next? As far as, you know, what are the things that we could find out and all the different sources of news and where do we pull our information from? I kind of see this as an actually, you know, maybe end with a hopeful note of sorts. I think it's actually a kind of a good thing in the end, because with all this information that is out there, and obviously you're not going to get to all of it, but I think it's important that people then can see what is the extent of the information that is available to us. And even though you know some of it is just flat out not true, you know that some of it is maybe what some people actually do believe is true, but is against what you want to call it, like what you want to believe. And then there's going to be folks who are, you know, kind of with you. And I'm always constantly trying to come up with assignments in my classes to make my students realize it's not so much the end result is how you get there and the methods that you use. You know, I remember constantly in third, fourth grade being told in math, show your work, you know? And I was like, but I know the answer. But I was told, show your work anyhow. And I think that's what we kind of have to do today. The next step, and I don't know how long it's going to take, it might take a decade or two, until we figure out ways to kind of look at the information that is out there and systematically come up with a good, cohesive, logical is maybe too strong of a word, but you know, a way to be able to handle all the stuff that's not true, all the stuff that's misleading, all the stuff that has got its own agenda, and acknowledge it and be able to move on and to figure out what is your answer to those things. Again, you know, in two or three, less than a month, you'll be voting in midterms, and how do you get to that actual particular button or lever or whatever it is that you're doing to cast your vote? How did you get there? What did you disregard? What did you take into account? And I think as society-wise, we get better at that. I think it's actually encouraging. I think it's something that in the end, we're going to be able to come up with a way, and maybe they'll figure out some way to counter that, you know, to some extent. But I really think that, you know, in the next decade or two, I think we will be able, if not sooner, because things always seem to be speeding up, we'll come up with a way to deal with all these potential traps and fake news things and clickbaits and all those other things. So I'm actually kind of encouraged, and maybe it was good I was the last one to speak because I can leave on a bunch of hope, but I think it's not a horrible thing. I think if you're aware, I think that's the biggest part of what's going on now. And then figure out what to do afterwards with that.
Thank you so much. We're going to get Michael to his game now. Remember, right in the bar there, I think he said Miller Lights.
Yes.
They're
let's,
on.
Let's
they're
clean
on
them out. Let's clean them out of Miller Lights. There's probably about seven left. I counted last night.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight. There is a survey. If you haven't filled it out yet, if you would, please fill this out. This really helps the committee go forward from this event. So please take a moment before you leave to fill that out and then hand it in. We always end with some words of wisdom. We hope you consider all that you have heard tonight. Tonight, the quote will be from American journalist and humorist Robert Quillen, and it's a short one. Discussion is an exchange of knowledge, an argument, an exchange of ignorance. So here is to civility. Have a great night. Thank you.